The reigning two-time champion Adrian Devereaux starts his title defense by winning the Delano Pole Award for the first race of 2013. He did likewise last year. You see the starting grid scrolling across the top of the screen, and you might notice that the major story is all of the silly season changes. Chris Davenport is running for Rookie of the Year with Michael Sykes at the new Alert team. They were formerly called Flash Racing. Leonard Roderick has moved over to Volpe, and Greg Woodard and Kurt Pliskin have teamed up with Lycoya at Powersing Incorporated. Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. is among the rookie class, as well as Ike Durbin, no relation to former driver's champion Tony Durbin. Scott Soidler and Chris Johans make up the potent new combination over at Manticore Engineering. And of course, some things have remained the same. Ian Cooper and Scott Bates still at Team EFR. Kevin Dwyer has moved over to the Mitchell & Sons team. Luciano Soverall, you see back there in 30th on the grid. He had a rather nasty spin on his first lap, and he starts way back in the field as a result. And of course, Yevgeny Kuznetsov in car number 8 crashed in qualifying, and he starts last on the grid. Dan, off to you. Thank you, Lance. This 2-mile super speedway should provide a pretty good race here as Adrian Devereaux leads the field to the green, and they're spreading out wide already. There's plenty of room for these cars to go 4 wide down the front straightaway, and they are clearly doing that as he pulls away from Yulian Asova in the red Katsev. We're going to have to get used to some of the new paint jobs here, but Adrian Devereaux's car looks pretty much exactly the same as it did last year, and he's pulling away from the field early. Devereaux, great jump on the field. Gaspar D'Souza in the double zero car, that black and teal car, got a pretty slow start, and he's dropping back as Arto Kekkonen moves up into second in that silver and blue car. Here is D'Souza in the double zero car for Black Diamond Racing. He got this ride because he won the Independence Trophy last year in dramatic fashion at British Columbia, and he's having a pretty good start to his season, but, he's dropping through the field ever so slightly, but the Portuguese driver hanging on as best he can. He was very quick in practice and prized many by qualifying third as they are 4 wide right there. We're looking at Davina Henton. That is Henton, one of the Lynx cars. These cars look exactly the same. Lynx, the fashion company, formed its own team from the remains of Majestic Motorsports. Cars 11 and 12, Davina Henton and Melanie Cleveno. You can tell them apart because Cleveno's car has a white spoiler on it. And, of course, Cleveno's car is the number 12 on it. But Henton in the 11 car, moving her way forward. She won in British Columbia last year. Here's Chris Davenport, 26-year-old Chris Davenport. He married former champion Alexis Rainsford during the offseason. He's from San Francisco, so this is his home race. And, Davenport's had a rather messy season so far. He crashed in just about every session in testing. And he actually crashed in his second qualifying lap, but the lap he did on his first lap was good enough to put him very high up the grid. Davenport so far, not exactly one of the drivers people want to have around them. Here is Melanie Cleveno a bit further back in the field. That is Jose Luis Martinez in the zero on her inside. That is one of the Manticore cars. That is Scott Stoiler. And a couple cars on her outside. Peter Short in the 22, the former 4-time world champion Peter Short in car 22. Watch out for him throughout tonight's race. As you see there, Melanie Cleveno, car number 12, beginning to move her way forward. And here is the 2004 Master Cup Series Drivers' Champion Matt Taylor representing SAR in the Independence Trophy, running last year's Eagle. So Matt Taylor running a 2012 SAR Eagle and trying to make the most of it in the Rick Milligan car number 15. Not a whole lot of sponsorship on this car, but we'll have to see what Taylor can do with a underpowered car. The SARs weren't exactly the best cars last season. And here is the man in the back we're watching, the Brazilian Luciano Soverall, who lost the Drivers' Championship last year by about 10 feet as he is making his way around the outside of one of the FPO cars. That is Marcus Leonard. FPO has had their own struggles during the offseason. Their main sponsor, Umbrella Corporation, was supposed to sponsor both Marcus Leonard, who is in this race with the promoter's option, and Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. However, problems forced them to back out. As you can see, the second of the black FPO cars right in front of this group. Here's Davina Henton, the 11. Oh, we got problems! Henton in the wall! There was contact between Gaspar D'Souza and Yamino Tenshi in the yellow 25, and mayhem just ensued there. It looked like, possibly... Okay, watch the yellow car. That is Yamino Tenshi coming on the inside. Gaspar D'Souza in the double zero car. Tenshi takes the corner, and D'Souza takes the corner at the same time, and they make contact and both go shooting up into the track. Greg Woodard, Luciano Soverall, and Davina Henton caught up in that mess. Woodard goes out of the race. Henton goes out of the race, and as well as Yamino Tenshi in the clockwork car number 25. Tenshi, of course, is in this race with the promoter's option, but Luciano Soverall's night has gone sour very, very early on. 5 laps into the new season is not what he wanted. Adrian Devereaux in car number one leads the field. He has led every single lap so far. As the field begins to spread out a little bit on the restart, trying to get some space on each other, Devereaux is liking what he sees behind him. Two, three, four wide. A little bit, not quite four wide. Looks like everyone has a bit more sense than that right now. You can do four wide here. This track is definitely wide enough, but whether or not you want to do that on a restart is a bit questionable. But Devereaux pulling away here in car number one. And not a whole lot has changed on that team, and clearly it shows. Here's Zelda Ashby in one of the other FPO cars. Of course, this is Marcus Leonard's team. He owns the team, brought it up to the Master Cup Series. They've run in Arla and in TM Lights, and they've won in both series. Almost won the Arla Championship, and they're only in their first attempt in that category. So clearly, this is a team with a lot of strong engineers on there. So maybe not the most well-funded operation out there, but they do have it where it counts. This red 5 is Michael Sykes, as he goes around his young teammate Chris Davenport, and he works his way up to third. The red 5, Michael Sykes, bringing Launch's red alert car to the front, and he's putting everyone on red alert because I don't think anyone expected him to come out of the gate this quick. The alert cars weren't exactly at the top of their game during testing. Perhaps they were sandbagging. Here's Leonid Roderick over at Volpe. Yes, Leonid Roderick has moved from the Flash Racing, now called Alert, over to Volpe. Roderick is teamed with Packer Carroll on this team, and the Aperture Science Volpe is beginning to work its way forward. That orange number 4 is now going after his former teammate, Michael Sykes, as Roderick in car number 4, well ahead of Packer Carroll, the second of the Aperture Volpes. They're both very distinctive from each other. Now here is a 7th place car. That yellow car is Matthias Tau, the Swedish driver. His seat was in doubt for a while during the offseason because I think Gessler was looking for him to be a lot stronger than he was in 2012. But the 26-year-old Swede is currently putting up a fight against Arto Kekkonen so far in this race. In fact, I think he's ahead of him. So Taub has clearly gotten off to a pretty good start to his 2013 campaign. His 2012 campaign was very, very messy. Got into a lot of collisions and had a lot of mechanical problems as well. Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. in car number 99 is the first Sealander to start a TM Master Cup Series race. He attempted to cater back in 09, but he's been around in the TM Junior Series, TM Light Series, and in Arla since then. He has many wins in Arla and in TM Lights, and he's definitely one of the better rookies I think we've seen in quite some time. Quiggles Jr. driving, of course, for Marcus Leonard in FPO. Of course, as I mentioned earlier, their major sponsor pulled out at the last second, so that's why these cars are in yellow yellow car Chris Davenport beginning to hound him a little bit. I was looking at the 6 car, but they're still in the black and red of the Umbrella Corporation. Of course, all these scandals involving them meant they had to pull their sponsorship from this team kind of at the last second, but they're doing a pretty good job given the circumstances. Zach Duff in car number 74 and his dilated sponsorship moved over to the Mitchell & Sons team and their new Juno S3s. He's currently running in 13th place, and Packer Carroll, really not giving Duff a lot of room there. Looked like the 2 car just almost shot up right into the rear quarter panel, the 74, but the Junos are known for being very, very dependable cars, and considering what happened to Zach Duff last season, where he seemed to retire every other race due to mechanical difficulties, I'm pretty sure he'll be feeling very confident knowing that he has probably one of the most reliable cars in the field under him. However, the Juno is not exactly known for being the fastest car on the racetrack, but he's doing a great job given the circumstances. Here is Packer Carroll, who is, you can just see, is under watch for that move on Zach Duff. And, gets in the back of Davenport, it looks like. Now, here's something funny about that. Packer Carroll expressed some feelings about Davenport's wife some years ago. You can make what you want about that. anyways, on the inside, that's Ian Cooper in his usual 777, the orange and black car, the Lysander car. Beginning to make a move on Packer Carroll, who also I'd like to point out is from California. So, right behind those 2 cars, Zach Duff in car 74, but Ian Cooper in the 777 car beginning to not play nice with Packer Carroll either. So, guess Ian Cooper didn't really like what Packer was doing to Davenport. But, anyways, that being said, Packer Carroll is already under watch for his driving so far. He's not exactly doing himself any favors. Azuma Kazuyama in the number 19 car is in this race with the promoter's option. Now, this is the 3rd Nomoto, but actually, this car has been prepared and being run by the SOS team, the Speed SOS bunch. Of course, they're a very prominent TM Lights team. They do a lot of work with Nomotos across the country, and looks like Star Namoto Racing has given them one of their cars, given them Kazuyama, and said, do what you can. And they're doing quite a bit, because they're ahead of Troy Adams in the factory, in one of the factory cars, in the 18, anyway. Here's Leonid Roderick as he begins to hunt down Yulia Nasova in car number 7, the Katsev. That's going to be a hard car. It's kind of hard to see the number on that car on the door, anyway, but you can see it just fine on the roof, so... Anyways, unfortunately, Nasova and Kuznetsov have identical cars, but Roderick goes up into second place, and Roderick now goes after Adrian Devereaux. He is by far the quickest car in the track right now. So the Aperture Volpe is beginning to go hastily towards the front of this field as Adrian Devereaux in car number 1. Perhaps he's just taking it easy a little bit now that he's built up a lead, but Roderick really beginning to turn the pressure up in that car number 4. Devereaux is kind of driving out of his mirrors right now, I just noticed, because not exactly making Roderick's life easy. Here we are back with Matthias Taub in the number 10 Myosoft car, the number 10 Gessler. As he's begun to work his way forward, he's gotten around Michael Sykes, moved his way up into fourth. That's Nasova in front of him. Arto Kakinen is that silver car, silver and blue car directly behind Sykesy. And here is Sykesy may have a run on Taub as we ride on board with Arto Kakinen in the 9. As we see coming into 1, these cars are going very, very quickly around this racetrack. There are a lot of concerns about the speeds here, but these cars are backing off about 20 miles an hour in the corners, but the straight line speeds are just unbelievable. For some of these cars, the fastest cars in the field are hitting about 210 coming into 1, but look at this run that Arto's got coming off 4 as he's gotten a run around Michael Sykes. There's his teammate Taub doing a pretty good job at making Arto's life easy. So good teamwork by the Gessler guys, it looks like, to benefit both of them, because it looks like they may be sort of gifted third and fourth here, because Tao may have a run on Nasova coming off too, but oh, Kekkonen looks like he was better through the center there. Coming off, it looks like the Gesslers have gotten third and fourth, settled for themselves, as Sykes now makes a run and takes over fifth, dropping Nasova in the 7 car back to sixth. Pretty good racing early on in the game. This is a much better race than most people, I think, were expecting to see at this racetrack. Here's the second Katsevov. You have Jenny Kuznetsov. However, Kuznetsov is running way back in 29th, so he's not really having an ideal start to his TM Master Cup Series as a full-time career anyway with Katsev Engineering. He's definitely one of the more colorful rookies we've seen in quite some time, and he's quite the fan favorite. He's been doing a lot of fan tours around the infield lately, and humoring a lot of people with his great sense of humor, great guy. And we hope to see a lot of Yevgeny Kuznetsov in the future in this series, because here he is having a run on the that blue car is the 31 of Jacob Eichel. It's one of the Independence Trophy cars, and Kuznetsov makes the move. And the Katsevs weren't all that bad in testing, but Kuznetsov has seemed to really struggle here during practice. But it looks like he's turned it up when it counts in the race, because he's beginning to work his way forwards. Here's Ben Atkins in car number 50 in the second to Tino, car number 50. Atkins, former Dash Cup champion, is being passed on the outside by Luciano Savaral, who has damage on that car from being involved in the lap 5 caution. So Atkins not exactly having a great start to his night in this 50 car. He's not exactly been on the same pace as his teammate, Alessandro Rossini, but he's kept the car off the wall, which is more than I can say for some of Tutino's former drivers. Here's Ryan Matthews in car number 61, driving his own car, the Matthews Aspira. Yeah, it's the first time this car's really had a good run out in its Independence Trophy campaign anyway, as he's having a run on that green and bronze car of Craig Yoncer. Craig Yoncer in the Scarabs car. The Scarabs gone with a green livery this year. And here's the other Tutino, car number 42, Alessandro Rossini. The new TR13 is actually a car that Rossini penned himself, so did a lot of the design work, actually, so a lot more Italian influences on the very Italian Scuderia Tutino, as he's being passed by Frank Azure, the Long Islander, in car number 46. But Rossini's having a pretty solid evening so far. He competed under the name Milano Rossini in the past. Here's Chris Johans in car number 29, former Arla champion. He's having a run in the Manicor car this year. That's not really the most well-funded team in the world, and it's really a surprise that Johans would take up this option. But to be quite honest with you, I think it's going to be very, very exciting to see through this season what Johans is able to do with a car that may not exactly be the best car in the field in that Manicor car. Now, here is Ike Durbin in car number 98. This is one of the Terra International Motorsports cars, and I think he's been holding up everyone behind him, because you can see there's a huge gap in front of him, and, well, there's a huge wad of cars forming behind him. a lot of money behind Terra International Motorsports. Lycoya has thrown a lot of money at this series in general, which is nothing but a good thing. And clearly it's showing, because Ike Durbin having a strong run. Good to see the Lycoya Brigade having a good start to their season. Two Gessler drivers look like they're holding station for now. Not a whole lot to see here, but we see Michael Sykes and Yulina Sova doing battle, and looks like Zelda Ashby may be drawn up into that as well. But anyway, you get to see a good shot of Arto Kekkonen's new livery. Mostly the same as last season, but it's got a lot more blue on it than he did previously. Car number 9 won a few races last year. Now he's looks like he's gotten tired of sitting back there in 4th. Wants a taste of 3rd, and he's going to give Taub a real run for his money. But Taub gives him space, gives him plenty of space. Taub opting to try the high side. Coming into 1, but it looks like the low line is going to be the place to be. Because Arto Kekkonen's car just really seems hooked up here in 1 and 2. And Taub's still fighting back. Matthias Taub hanging on the outside. So Taub may have made the right choice by sticking to the high line. But Arto Kekkonen may have him down here in 3 and 4. Because Taub looks like didn't get such a good entry into 3. And yes, Arto Kekkonen takes over 3rd. But it took him quite a while to do it because Taub wasn't willing to give it up. The racer and Taub showing through there. Zelda Ashby has gotten around Michael Sykes as we look on board the Red 5. There's Yulina Sova in the 7. And there's Ashby in the FPO car. The FPO Terminator T9000. There is car number 55. Pretty much the usual Zelda Ashby livery on that car. Number 55, and not a whole lot's changed over there. Ashby just as quick as she usually is. And FPO could possibly have a very good result in its first race. We look off the right side of the car number 5, the Red 5 of Michael Sykes. There is the Katsev car, and you can see that's why the door number is going to be so hard to read, is because they made them so small. Anyways, Ian Cooper, Lewis Kingston, Packer Carroll in this mix, along with, I believe that's Marcus Leonard. Yeah, I think that is Leonard. And we got it's the 777 car, lift off a little bit early. Anyways, 777 car looks like he might have gotten a little sideways, Ian Cooper, and just backed off a little bit, so that was just a little hiccup there. Anyways, that is Marcus Leonard. Lewis Kingston there as well. And there's another car in the back of that. That is Martinez. Jose Luis Martinez in the Alex Harrison Zero car. Very distinctive car. The Alex Harrison Zero car, that's actually last year's Omeka, the MA03. They opted not to run the MA04, so... Martinez really getting on the back of Cooper coming off two there. So that 777 car not handling well at all. Here's Chris Davenport in the centered on Davenport anyway. The yellow car number 6, the launch lemon car. Oh, Davenport. Whoa, Packer Carroll makes a dive on Davenport. Almost collides with the 6 car. And considering the speeds are going over there, that would have been a rather almighty shunt. So, Davenport used his head a little bit there and, avoided a much bigger situation from springing up there. Davenport, car number 6, hanging on there, but looks like he's holding up quite a few people back there. He made a habit of doing that last year, especially during Carriola Grand Prix pre-qualifying, where a lot of people missed the field just because of Davenport's defensive driving skills. And Davenport has a run on Packer Carroll. They're playing bumper tag over there at about 200 miles an hour. That's not necessarily the smartest thing in the world. Here's Ian Cooper going 3 wide. Oh, the 777 car is slowing. Yes, the 777 car has just... There's smoke building out the back of that car, so Ian Cooper's night is over. Looks like those weren't just the car stepping out. He was having some more serious issues, and his night ends early. The DFR Journey A90. Very unfortunate for Ian Cooper. Here's Evgeny Kuznetsov in the 2nd Katsev, and he begins to slow on the track as well, and he brings it in, and unfortunately, Kuzi's night ends early. It's a big disappointment for Kuznetsov. He was really beginning to march his way forward. We look forward to seeing what he can do at the next race in Carbondale. Very popular Russian rookie driver. Here's Kevin Dwyer, who won last year at Brazil. The son of the 6-time Master Cup Series champion, Benny Dwyer, running in midfield with his teammate, Zach Duff. Dwyer's had a rather slow start to off-season testing. Nothing really eventful happened over with the Mitchell & Sons team during testing. At least that's what he told us. But I have a feeling Dwyer and Duff are chasing the speed of this car. And it looks like over long runs, the 72 is a little better than the 74, at least judging from what I saw right there. And there's the 18 car of Troy Adams, the TM Lights champion from last year. The Australian driver in the number 18 Nomoto. Now here is Chris Johans in the 29, beginning to make things exciting here. in the lower midfield here with Jacob Eichholz and Matt Taylor. And, well, it's one of the Lynx cars that's got to be Melanie Cleveno because Henton's out of the race. So, anyways, Chris Johann's got a lot of different sponsors on that car in the 29 car, and he begins to slow on track. Is he? Yes, this looks like a scheduled pit stop. Chris Johann's enters the pits very early on lap 33. Leonid Roderick pits on lap 34 in car number 4, the Aperture Science Volpe. And looking back to see who else pits on lap 34, his teammate Packer Carroll, Lewis Kingston in the number 17 Nemoto, and Adrian Devereaux in on lap 35. So Devereaux stays out an extra lap. And after Adrian Devereaux hits the pit lane, everybody else would have made a pit stop except for Scott Bates in the 88 car, and we'll see him in a minute. Here is Nasova, that looks like Quiggles Jr. back there, and Kirk Pliskin in that brilliant purple and yellow car. Here's Scott Bates in the 88 car, last car to pit. He stayed out until lap 36, and Leonid Roderick has the lead after the first round of pit stops. So Roderick in car number 4 holds the lead over Adrian Devereaux back there in second place. As you see the running order on the left side. Nasova holding station in fifth. As you look back through, that's everybody on the lead lap. So 31 of the 38 starters are on the lead lap, and a few cars having dropped by the wayside. Here is Devereaux, though, going for the lead, as Roderick did not hold the lead for very long before the Frenchman was able to get by him and take back first. However, Roderick is fighting back. He really does not want to see Devereaux pull away from the rest of the field because Roderick has not actually passed Devereaux on the racetrack. He was only able to get by Devereaux in the pits. So, we'll have to wait and see how if Roderick's able to fight back. Here's the Black Diamond cars fighting amongst each other. Peter Short and Gaspar de Souza. That's Peter Short in the black and blue 22. And there's, of course, that's his teammate D'Souza in the 00, the teal car, very distinctive car. Chris Johann's in the Manicor, number 29, looking on the inside of Peter Short. Of course, Short is a 4-time world champion, and Formula A, as Johann's gets by him without too many difficulties. And Adrian Devereaux beginning to encounter some of the back markers. That is Ben Atkins in the number 52 Tino, former Dash Cup champion over in Europe. And Adrian Devereaux looks like he's not going to have too many problems getting by the Englishman, who appears to be struggling with that car quite mightily. So Atkins definitely got his hands full, but Devereaux not having too many problems getting by him. And that's his teammate up there. So I wonder if Luciano Savrol is going to make life easy for Adrian Devereaux. Considering by Devereaux's line, I would suggest, Luciano's not going to put up much of a fight there. Looks like Roderick may have had a bit more problems getting by Atkins than Devereaux did, because Roderick fell way back behind the 50 car. Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. in car number 99 has worked his way up to 10th. That's his teammate Zelda Ashby in 9th and Kirk Pliskin in 8th. Here is Devereaux now going by the other Tutino, Alessandro Rossini, formerly competed in the series as Milano Rossini. He has some Master Cup Series experience, got a pole in his home race back at the back in Italy, back when the series used to run at an old karting facility back there. And here is Ryan Matthews in the 61 going a lap down. Matthews owns a TM Lights team. And he runs Brooke Ingvarsson in his TM Lights operation. Here is Frank Azure in the 46 car. This is not a very experienced driver or a very experienced team, but Azure has done a pretty good job so far, considering his very limited experience. And I could say the same about Ryan Matthews, really. Not a lot of experience there either. But Azure doing it very professional, giving Adrian Devereaux, the leader, plenty of room. The Long Islander having a solid start to his Independence Trophy campaign. Rossini does not appear to be being as good of a back marker for Leonid Roderick, it seems, because the 42 is deciding that he is going to actually race Roderick as if he's racing in four position. And I can't imagine that's making the people over at VRT very happy, especially because Adrian Devereaux is pulling away because of the back markers, actually. All of these back markers have actually helped Adrian Devereaux more than they've hurt him, and Devereaux has been very vocal about back markers being respectful to the leaders. Zach Duff, Melanie Cleveno, and Troy Adams battle for 22nd place. This is one of the better battles on the racetrack. 22nd place, you wouldn't think it mattered so much. No points awarded for 22nd. Apparently nobody told these guys, and Melanie Cleveno, obviously. And Luciano Savarol in car number 3 has pulled that car onto the apron. And Savarol's night appears to be over because he's going way too slowly. And yes, Luciano Savarol intends to be pulling that car off the racetrack. And his night is over as Melanie Cleveno begins to fight back against Zach Duff for 22nd place. She really wants all the pride that comes with 22nd, but Melanie Cleveno, last year's TM Europe champion and last year's TM Master Cup Series Rookie of the Year, is very, very hungry for a good result despite that dog of a car in the Lynx L313. Leonid Roderick now having to deal with Frank Azier and Ryan Matthews, who are busy racing each other for position, actually, so you can't really cry foul there between those two cars, as Adrian Devereaux has encountered Craig Janser in the 89 and Jacob Eichholtz in the 31. Both of those cars, Independence Trophy cars, cars 31 and 89. Devereaux getting by them without too much of a problem, and now he's caught up to that Semanicor car, and I believe that's Scott Stoiler. Now, that's not being very nice. I think Devereaux shook his fist at Stoiler when he went by, and that blue car is ahead of him is Matt Taylor. Arto Kekkonen is beginning to chase down Leonid Roderick in the number 4 car, but Roderick slows! Leonid Roderick is slowed, coming into, now he's pitting on lap 55. There appears to be some problems there with the Volpe, because Roderick's spending a lot of time in the pits. That's way too early for a scheduled pit stop, and that 4 car is going to lose several laps in the pits. Big tragedy there, but we're having a good battle on track for 17th between Marcus Leonard, Peter Short, Azuma Kazuyama. It looks like Kevin Dwyer and Gasper D'Souza might want a piece of this, as Peter Short currently holds 17th place, which at 6 points. So there you go. There is actually some points to be gained. This is the bottom half of the bottom few points positions, so they do have quite a bit to fight over. In the meantime, Adrian Devereaux has just put Troy Adams a lap down in the 18 car. Troy Adams, the Australian, having a good start to his career so far. Chris Johans pitting on lap 60 in the number 29 car. He was one of the first cars to pit on the first cycle of pit stops. Matt Taylor in the 15 has already come in into the pits, as Adrian Devereaux in car number 1 is going to pit on lap 61 in the car number 1. So who else is coming into the pits on this lap? Looks like, well, Roderick's still in the pits. He hasn't left the pit lane yet. Here he comes. Here comes the 4 car out. As Adrian Devereaux comes in, you see Arto Kekkonen coming in. Ryan Matthews is just leaving the pits. Ben Atkins is in. Let's see who else we can see on this way out of the pits. I guess nobody else, as we go back to following Leif Scott Stoiler in 28 cars. Martinez comes out of the pits. Craig Janser comes in. Michael Sykes and Scott Bates looks like they're coming in. This is lap 62. That's one of the FPO cars coming out. Fortunately, they'll be using a different paint job for Quiggles Jr., I think, for the upcoming races, assuming Marcus Leonard doesn't get the promoter's option, I think. But after the second round of pit stops, Adrian Devereaux holds the lead over the two Gesslers and Scott Bates and then Yulina Sova. So, 21 cars still on the lead lap, and several cars went a lap down. A lot of them were either a lap down already or they had bad pit stops, and you can see Leonard Roderick's night really can't get much worse. He's 7 laps behind. And Adrian Devereaux has really just pulled away from everybody else. Not much of a battle up here. So let's go back to 13th. Jose Luis Martinez in car number 0. Oh, we got contact. Packer Carroll's hooked the back of the 0. Martinez goes around and he's rolled it. Twy rolls it over. And, wow, that looked blatant to me. I don't know what Martinez did to upset Packer Carroll. But the most amazing thing is we don't even have a caution flag coming out for that. Now, that was a very, very high-speed crash. Very scary-looking incident. Give the flagger a shot of adrenaline, but more specifically, let's send Packer Carroll some anger management classes, because I don't know what he was thinking there. Just hooked the back of the 0 car, and there is no way at all that was unintentional, because he was still flat out into the side of the 0 car until about midway through the corner when he realized that the 0 car was going into the wall, and the stewards really wanted a word with Packer Carroll, and I can't see why, but please invite the flagger in as well to give him a shot of adrenaline. The red 5 of Michael Sykes has moved his way up to 5th place. He and Nasova have dispatched Scott Bates, and he begins to make a run on the Gesslers. Adrian Devereaux, in the meantime, is putting the Black Diamond cars a lap down. That's Kevin Dwyer back there in that blue 72, and Azuma Kazuyama as well behind Dwyer. They are closing in on Chris Johans in the number 29 Manicor Engineering car. The Manicor M1A1, the car that Alexis Rainsford sat in the pole with at the Carriola Grand Prix last year, that a lot of people raised several complaints about. They haven't really done any development work, apparently, since that race, and it's showing. But Chris Johans is still giving that car a very, very solid run, and I'm surprised that there's not a whole bunch of debris that these cars could be running over or cutting tires down. In fact, I'm positive that there is, but the fact that no one's cut a tire down from that is just amazing in and of itself. Frank Azier, car number 46, is out from a very solid 27th place given his limited experience. And apparently during that last pit stop cycle, a 15 car of Matt Taylor, they had some rather serious transmission issues there, and he has not come back onto the track in that 15 car. I would suspect that they will withdraw that car and that his night is over. 13 cars are on the lead lap at this point of the race. Melanie Cleveno is running in 14th, and she's had a very good charge to the field, and there's a pretty good battle here for 14th. Kevin Dwyer in this mix, Gaspar Souza, Chris Johans. This has been the best battle of the race, is right back here in the midfield with the two Black Diamond cars. Probably should have spent a lot more time focusing on what happened to Gaspar Souza, because he's been right in the middle of a very, very strong battle here in the midfield, and that's clearly been the most exciting thing to watch here, and well, we're getting some good racing somewhere. But here's Packer Carroll running up in 11th place. He's got Davenport and Kingston behind him. But I think Davenport and Kingston are just laying low a little bit rather than pushing it, because with the way Packer Carroll's been driving, I think Davenport and Kingston don't want to end up in the ambulance, considering some of Packer Carroll's antics. And he's already been warned for his driving, and clearly he hasn't done himself too many favors. Ben Atkins in the 50 car is going another lap down on lap 76. But it's really hard to show what talent he has in that Tutino, and that car has looked very, very ill-handling, and I'm surprised he hasn't just put it in the wall, so he's done a pretty good job just keeping it on the road at this point. Scott Bates is sitting very quietly in 6th place. The number 4 car of Leonard Roderick appears to be quicker than Scott Bates, but Bates is 7 laps ahead of him, so I don't think there's too much incentive for Scott Bates to really be racing Roderick. Actually, if Bates lets Roderick go, he could theoretically have Roderick break up the cars in front of him, give Bates a solid run at the two cars in front of him. Zach Duff in car number 74 slows on the racetrack, and, his 2013 is starting to look a lot like 2012, where he had lots of mechanical failures because his night ends with electrical problems, and that is Ben Atkins in the number 52 Tino blowing smoke out the back of that car, so it looks like. Not only did he have an ill-handling race car, but he had quite a bit of mechanical problems as well, and he's doing some landscaping service. Well, that's nice of him. The battle for fourth place is beginning to heat up between Yulian Asova and Michael Sykes, two very red cars. And considering that this race is at night, it might be a little hard to tell the difference between the two. Just have to look at the hood logos, basically. Michael Sykes in car number 5 holding the outside, Yulian Asova on the inside. Asova, car number 7, tries to have a run down the front straight, but Michael Sykes holds her off on the outside, so the Red 5 having a very strong run. The Welshman, touring car legend around the world, is really taken to the TM Master Cup Series racing very well. And he's won a race in every season. He's competed in every competed for the full season. Here's Scott Bates in the 88 car catching Yulian Asova. And he's having quite a bit of fun here racing Leonard Roderick. And I thought that Bates racing Roderick would be counterproductive, but apparently not, because Bates and Roderick have actually caught Yulian Asova. Lewis Kingston, Chris Davenport, and Ebenezer Quiggles Jr. have apparently overcome their fear of Packer Carroll bulldozing them, and they've picked up the pace and are having a pretty epic duel here for 9th place. Davenport currently holds it. Kingston in the 17 car is on the inside of Quiggles Jr. And Quiggles Jr. is going to go to the inside and hold off Kingston, it looks like, but Kingston wasn't really there. Packer Carroll way to the outside in the 2 cars. He drops back a little bit. Packer Carroll, car number 2. I'll have to see if the stewards do anything about some of his driving after this race is over. Anyways, haven't really talked about this guy all race long. Ike Durbin running in 8th place in the Lycoya Brute for the Independence Trophy. This performance should be expected given the amount of money that Lycoya has thrown at those cars. And here's another Lycoya, Kurt Pliskin. Very, very brilliant paint job on this Snake Coil 16 car. And Pliskin having a strong run in 7th. But I don't think the Lycoyas are getting very good fuel mileage, so we could have a fuel mileage race in our hands. This is a 90-lap race. Your car's pitting in lap 30, lap 60. Well, you can do the math there. Here's Matthias Taub, who's running in 3rd place, and he's one of the cars that looks like he might be in trouble on fuel. And yes, he is slowing. Taub is going to have to pit for fuel. He was one of the cars that stopped very early, along with Chris Johans and Kurt Pliskin in the 16. So unfortunately, Pliskin runs into fuel dramas along with Jacob Eicholtz in that 31 car. But up at the front of the field, Adrian Devereaux looks like he is going to have clear sailing in car number 1. He's controlled the entire race. He's going to put Chris Davenport a lap down. And coming into turn number 3, Devereaux, car number 1, the Frenchman, got a perfect 70 in the first race of 2012, and it looks like he's set to do that for the first race here in 2013. He stretches the field all the way and led all but five laps to claiming his first win of the 2013 season in the very first race. Devereaux over Arto Kekkonen and Michael Sykes to complete the podium. Yulianna Sova and pretty strong run over there for Katsev. Katsev doesn't quite have the same funding they did last year. Scott Bates, a solid top five effort. But the big hero of the night has got to be Ike Durbin in car number 98. Didn't really talk about him a whole lot, but he had a very, very quiet race. Not a whole lot happened to him. He wasn't really in any great battles for position. However, he brought the Terra International Motorsports Lycoya, the Timmy car, up to sixth. And that's the highest the Independence Trophy car is, and one of two of them that made it into the points. Chris Davenport and Ebenezer Quiggles Jr., solid runs from them. And Lewis Kingston rounded up ninth place. Packer Carroll wound it up 10th. But 2 hours after the race, Carroll was excluded from the race results, bumping Melanie Cleveno up to 10th in the Lynx racing car. Gaspar D'Souza inherited 11th. Azuma Kazuyama voted in with the promoter's option, and he was the highest finishing of all the cars that were awarded the promoter's option for this race. Peter Short in the 22. Kevin Dwyer had a pretty solid run to finish 14th. Matthias Taub, of course, fuel dramas plagued him. Troy Adams, Craig Yonser, a great run for him and that small team. It's another Independence Trophy car, as the little eye there on the little graphic there indicates. Scott Stoiler, Kurt Pliskin, fuel dramas dropped him to 19th when he had a solid top 10 run going. And with Packer Carroll being excluded from the race, Alessandro Rossini and Scuderia Tutino walk away from the first race of the season with 1 point in the bag. Great job by Tutino and all of the underslept mechanics over there. They had a pretty hectic week, and it's good to see that they got a good reward out of it. And as you might expect, this is how the championship sits, provisionally, providing, of course, that Packer Carroll is not reinstated to the results, because VRT has appealed that penalty given to Carroll, but I'm not entirely sure if I sympathize with them or not. It seems like a very extreme penalty to hand out, but at the same time, he did basically intentionally wreck Jose Luis Martinez at over 200 miles an hour, so I can see the steward's point of view, in this case, anyway. And let's see how the Independence Trophy shapes up. There are 27 Independents competing this season, and it's no surprise that Ike Durbin leads the table. And, of course, Craig Yonser had a solid run. Jacob Eichholz, Ryan Matthews, and Frank Azure all had were running towards the back of the field for most of the race, but they all were able to get the job done in a very, very solid runs for all of them. And, of course, Matt Taylor in the 15 car is currently sitting sixth in the Independence Trophy. Each Independent runs four races in which they score Independent points. Jose Luis Martinez is actually running for the Independence Trophy, but he was voted in this race with the promoter's option, so he does not score Independence Trophy points for this race. There's a couple of bruised egos in the field, and the next race is the short track at Carbondale, where some of those bruised egos may just create a very explosive situation on that short triangle in southern Illinois.